All right, let's go ahead and start. There's too much anticipation here. I'm Greg Tito, managing editor of The Escapist, and I am here to talk about the future of playing a role in video game RPGs. The most exciting topic with the most boring title ever. I apologize, I couldn't come up with a more better way to say it. But I'm joined by this illustrious panel here before me, and I'm going to, as a way of introducing them, I'm going to ask them a question, because, you know, I don't like the clapping, and then, you know, and then we had to get into the real panel, so we're just going to jump right in. That's what we do. So I'm going to start with Dave Georgeson, who is the lead designer and creative director. Director of Development.
There you go.
That's the real title. At SOE for the EverQuest franchise. And I'm going to start by asking, what is your favorite moment in playing computer role-playing games that you felt like you had the most impact on the story and the world?
Had the most impact. Well, there's a moment that had the most impact on me.
Yeah, a personal moment. Yeah.
So the first time I was, this is kind of a silly story, but it was one of the things that kind of opened my eyes about what MMOs could be. I was playing Ultima Online right after, I mean, like the first day it came out, and I was walking down the road from Britannia, and I saw this stick in the middle of the road, and as I approached it, the stick said, "Hey, I'm a magical stick, and I've fallen out of the trees. Please throw me back in the woods." And I didn't know better. I was like, okay, fine, it's a magical world, sure, why not? So I pick up the stick and I throw it into the woods, and then the guy that was cloaked invisible on the road that had positioned his word bubble so it looked like it came out of the stick laughed and laughed and laughed and ran off into the woods. And that was when I realized, oh my God, this is not a single player game. I can't stop playing this kind of game. That kind of crap can happen all the time. And I've been making MMOs since.
That's not usually how that story ends.
It was before the real PKing started.
Usually he's wearing
first
his
day.
Pants.
First day.
It was the first day, so they didn't realize they could just kill you.
Yeah, exactly.
We're also joined by Ryan Dancey, who is the CEO of Goblin Works, making the Pathfinder Online MMO.
I'm going to take a panelist license and talk about a tabletop game, not a digital game.
Okay, go ahead.
So it was the summer of 1980, and I was 12 years old, and the brother of a friend of mine taught me how to play Dungeons & Dragons. And teaching a 12-year-old in 1980 how to play Dungeons & Dragons is like giving crack cocaine to a lab rat. And that summer, we played that game every spare minute of every hour of every day. And somewhere in my heart, I said to myself, I want to grow up and I want to publish this game. And in 2000, I published the third edition of Dungeons & Dragons and fulfilled that life goal. And now I'm on a quest to bring that feeling to 12-year-olds and 22-year-olds and 82-year-olds in digital worlds in the same way I experienced it for the first time on the tabletop.
Nice. But not 92-year-olds.
No, they're out.
No, that's the situation. That's crazy. And we are joined by Mike Laidlaw, who is the creative director of Dragon Age at BioWare. Who's your favorite role-playing moment?
Well, I was on the parenting panel with Susan the other night, and this seems to be my let's talk about family kind of PAX. So it was managing to save my brother in Deus Ex. The original Deus Ex gave you this moment where, you know, Paul, who was the other cyborg guy in the blue trench coat, who looked exactly like you. And, you know, but Paul was actually a really well-done character. The first guy you met, he was kind of your moral conscience or whatever, and he spends the game kind of trying to nudge you in the right direction while, you know, crazy cyborg Russian guy is like, null cube! So Paul really had kind of gained some good space for me. And then, of course, there's that scene, sorry to spoil the 15-year-old game, but there's that scene where he's, you know, in his apartment and he's hurt and, you know, they're coming to kill him and he's like, go JC, get out. And, you know, up to that point, I cannot think of a single moment where I had been built to the point where I was like, no, I think maybe I can win this one.
Maybe I can do this. And you know, first time I tried, they just came in full force and rolled up hard, and it was just reload. but I was like, you know what? I don't know, man. Those guys took damage, right? And that was like my light in the darkness. I'm gonna do this. And I remember cheating to the point where I reloaded further back, got to outside his apartment, put like 17,000 landmines. Because by God, Paul was gonna live. And yeah, so he was like, go JC, they're coming, and I guess they spawned, and it was just like, you know, and then he immediately went, well, I guess we're safe. Which I remember thinking, well, the neighbors aren't, because a thin peg in the one apartment. But anyway, so, you know, you get out, and the fact that he's still around later in the game, right, he doesn't really play a major role. That's kind of the limitations of, you know, you can't give a guy millions and millions of things to say after. But he was still there, you could talk to him, he was in midday, and it was just so immensely satisfying to know that I was there. And back then, you know, we didn't have Twitter, so being able to say to him, no, you can do it. And that just impacted me so much to say that it wasn't just that I had done it, it's that the game recognized it, accounted for it, and put that option in there. And even if it was a minor reward, that part of the journey was just spectacular.
That's very cool.
Cool.
All right, well, I wanted to tell you something that you said, Brian, where like a lot of computer RPGs obviously were grown from the tabletop arena. And they were guys who were in the, you know, early 80s, late 70s who loved playing D&D and were trying to translate that experience to the computer, which was fairly new at that time. Programming was a new experience. And multi-user dungeons, MUDs, kind of grew from that thing. And those were all very text-based. You know, you go into a room and, you know, you'd have a line of text coming, and then because it was text-based, there was so much leeway, imagination that the player had to bring to what was going on, that actually felt a little bit more akin to a tabletop game than many of the games that we have now, which are, you know, very graphical and have voice acting and everything going on. So my question to you guys is to when, and if is it coming soon, has the technology advanced to a point where all of the permutations and all the things that could come from those multi-user dungeons can now exist in, you know, AAA large-scale MMOs or single-player RPGs? Dave, let's start with you. Big question, I know.
Yeah, hard to answer because I can't really get details until August 1st. Yes, absolutely. August 1st is when we unveiled EQ Next. I think most of you know that. We are pursuing those kinds of models a lot. I mean, that's one of the holy grails of MMOs in general. We've always wanted to be able to do that. I mean, it used to be back in the days of the MUDs and stuff like that, you'd become the 65th level star mage or whatever it was, and you'd finally get permission from the dude who was running it to be able to create your own space and everything like that, which is, you know, really similar to the UGC trees that we're chasing right now. And we've been experimenting a lot with that at SOE, and you can kind of imagine that we're going to be doing a lot more. John Smedley, our president, has gone on record as saying that the next game is a big sandbox, and he's not wrong. So that's one of the things that I really really believe in. I've made several sandbox games in the past, and one of the reasons why I really like them is because it allows the players to create their own stories, to create their own paths, to make their own marks in the world, and that kind of feeling of being able to have an effect on your environment and have an effect on what's going on around you is it's kind of a deep-seated need. It's a victory point that we don't normally describe, and it hasn't been available in a lot of MMOs before. So yeah, we got to push that boundary.
Nice. Well, Ryan, that is the tenet behind Pathfinder Online is sandbox versus theme park. We have actually, I wrote an article about it on escapistmagazine.com, at their website.
That was a plug too,
but yeah, it's not so subtle. But that seems to be, we are getting to that point where single player or, you know, single content in MMOs is no longer what is desired anymore.
So the biggest expense in most MMO projects is the art. And art requires a really large team of really highly trained expert people to develop and deploy to a game. And in a theme park game, in a classic game like World of Warcraft or EverQuest, a ton of art assets has to be created for all of the experiences that the players engage in. But in a sandbox game, the primary mode of interaction is between the players. And so you can produce a smaller amount of art assets and still generate a fractal space, tremendous variation in experience, because the players interacting with each other create the content. Are we going to get to a point in the short term where we could relive the mud days? It's hard to say, because a lot of the graphics processing in the mud era was done in your brain and didn't require a team of highly paid expert artists. In the medium to long term, I actually think that will be possible, because AI will develop sufficiently fast, and procedurally generated content will develop sufficiently fast, that the players, in creating their idea of what should be the world and how the world should work, will be assisted by the game itself in visualizing that stuff. So I think we're in a little bit of a transition period right now. In the short term, it's going to continue to be more in your imagination, and when you're interacting with people in an MMO, you're going to have to imagine some of the context and some of the subtle, you know, visual effects that aren't going to be there. But not too long from now, I think you'll get the visuals as well as the experience.
Very cool. Mike, do you have anything to add to that?
I think there's we're reaching a point where for years we've been chasing kind of a graphical fidelity target, right? Where it's each generation of hardware and every new engine and so on just push things further and further, more realistic or more detailed or whatever, to the point where we could overcome kind of the "that looks like a game" and "I can't take it seriously" or whatever the hurdles you were trying to overcome that supported your game. The graphics engines, you had to kind of focus on one thing and be it rages, megapixels, or whatever. So I think you're right. The graphics are catching up, because we're at a point now where visual fidelity is starting to be outstripped by visual direction in terms of what helps set you apart and what helps make you unique. So with the
art direction,
the way it looks and the style that you've chosen to go with. So, Wildstar. I think I've been seeing a lot of those trailers, and I went and checked it out, and I've been following it, and it's like, they're going to that with a fair amount of violence, and they're making that their thing. The stuff they're rendering is very artful. It's very, you can tell there's great tech behind it, but they're not straining the engine like a super, super high fidelity shooter might, which means that they're able to work with your creativity. So that's good. It means that if you don't have to work all that hard and you don't have to break everything with every piece of tech, then the art team actually can generate assets a lot faster, which again gives us more stuff to play with. And we see this in single player, same as you guys do. So that's a huge gain, and suddenly now it's about having style. And I think part of that style is when you look at a player experience in role play. When I think about myself on mods, it's about like describing my armor in a text field, right? Like, I crafted this, and the GM let me, or there was a system, and it's like, well then, let's get six paragraphs worth of details of the crafting. And that, I think, is where you see with more and more MMOs are, it's not just like three hairstyles and two colors anymore, right? It's a lot more like, nose sliders on stuff to really look like your own character. Wow, introducing transmutation systems, your armor looks like what you want. Games that are kind of RPGs, like Saints Row, having like bajillions of combinations. And I think that the personalization that the tech is letting us get to is the point where, in a month, that was the big thing. I had the unique title or the unique space or the unique thing, and that level of uniqueness is what helps you stand out from everybody else. And the more we can generate stuff, the more you can be unique, because you combine it in your own way, and that explosion is the end result. So, there you go.
Cool. How many times have you guys, when you're playing a RPG and you get to like a decision point, and you know it's a decision point, and sometimes games telegraph and sometimes they don't, but you're almost always like, well, I can be the good guy or the bad guy in this situation, and that characterization can be really, good, and I think we've gone to that point where morality systems are a thing that players are really used to, but how many of you guys played the Walking Dead Telltale game? All right, that's a fair number of you, right? That game, I thought, really well masked all those decisions. I mean, obviously there were some telegraphed ones, but there, in talking to interviews with them, there was 64 different permutations, so many different things that were tracked that I didn't even realize as I was playing that. I was just playing my story, and it became a very personal story for me. I want to ask you, Mike, as I was playing it, or actually more after I was playing, because I was trying to keep Clementine alive the whole time I was actually playing it. Is that possible in a AAA RPG where you have all the stat and the combat mechanics as well? Is it possible to get on the disc all of those permutations?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So, you know, the Dragon Ages typically have about 600 to 1,000 different plot variables. Something like Mass Effect 3, God, I forget, the stat was like, it was, Mass Effect 3 was something like quadruple the number of variables we'd had even in Mass 2, because you had to account for all the import stuff that had come forward, like is Morden dead, is Morden alive, is Staying dead, is Staying alive, and, because, you know, Mass 2, you could go on a grand party genocide if you really So that was, so they had to make all the content, all kinds of crazy stuff like that. So we track a lot of it. And where I think The Walking Dead were really showing is they did two things I thought were super, super smart. They were tracking a bunch of stuff, some of it really subtle, like apparently Clementine made a certain decision based on how you acted. And there was never a point where Clementine has now decided you're a dink. They did, like, to go to that point, they did post that up. I remember my favorite was Duck thinks you were totally awesome. Do you remember that one? Yeah. After the high five, and I'm like, that's so cool because they're being meta. But the fact that they basically said the game acknowledges that you have done a thing, and the game is aware of it, is that it, my good friend Patrick Weeks, he's one of our writers, he has an amazing phrase he calls card tricks in the dark, where you're doing all this cool complex stuff, but it's under the table and no one can see you're doing it. And what they did there is they surfaced it and they said, look, we're not going to tell you everything we're paying attention to, but the really notables, we're going to let you know this game's paying attention. And in a lot of ways, that was like a tutorial to say, make your decisions carefully because they're going to count, right? And they're going to show up, maybe in subtle ways. I think in Walking Dead, they were very subtle, but you know, the journey is part of that experience, and I think they did an amazing job of selling that.
Cool. Yeah. So, but over to the MMO, I didn't realize you guys split between MMOs and single player over here. That's kind of...
I like that I'm alone.
Yeah. It's a metaphor. Killing the monsters together.
If at the end you guys have like a million people show up and follow you around, yeah. And then
I'll be raiding your side of the table later.
Yeah. So then it's an allegory at that point.
But is that level of storytelling that Walking Dead and that brought to it, is that possible in an MMO?
Well, I'm going to answer really quickly because our MMO is focused on interactions between players, so we're not actually focusing on building a lot of that kind of complicated NPC-driven you know, experience into the game, but I suspect that you are. Well, you certainly have for whoever.
We'll get back to the player creator stuff. Okay, that's...
Yeah, the only tricky part again is that we haven't announced yet. So,
what can you say?
Exactly.
Yeah. In a word. Use code words.
In theory, basically, yes, that's what we should be going for, is we need to be able to set it up so that when you're going through a world and you're interacting with people, that your decisions have consequences. I mean, obviously, this is one of those holy grails that we would love to have in MMOs. The making that happen, of course, is really tricky because, like Mike was saying, there's this incredibly complicated state tables and stuff like that that you have to put together in order to be able to account for all those permutations. So in my humble opinion, if you're going to do that in an MMO, you have to pretty much restructure how you're doing AI. There are ways to do that. There's some really interesting things that are being explored by a bunch of people out there. You may see some of that out on the net. We're certainly aware of it, and we're definitely pushing that boundary. Yes, we want to do that.
All right, well, now, I think that's a perfect segue into the player-driven content, which you also, among your many credits at Wizards of the Coast and Legend of the Five Rings, also worked at CCP, working on EVE Online.
Yeah. Oh.
And that...
Well, hello.
I was interested to find out that game has what, it came out in 2003, yep. Right? And it has consistently grown audience year over year since that time, which is an amazing feat. When even, you know, World of Warcraft, the big elephant in the room, has gone up and down all over town, EVE Online has been up there constantly. And why do you think that is? What is it that drives that community to be so passionate?
Well, there's no doubt in my mind that EVE is a harbinger of an era of MMO development that we're all about to enter. And the guys at Iceland figured it out a long time ago, and that is that people interacting with other people is a more compelling experience than people interacting with a robot. At least in the short term. Maybe in the long term there'll be some amazing AI, which I totally agree will actually happen. It's actually the first note I had for this panel. So Eve demonstrates that you can have a very sparse game. When Eve was released, there was almost nothing that you could do. You could mine rocks and shoot each other. But they wrapped that very basic game mechanic in a tremendous social experience. The most important element in Eve is the corporation, which is a social graph of between 2 and 255 people. I think they go as high as 255, maybe higher than that. And then there's a metastructure, which is an alliance, which is basically a corporation of corporations. And in order to do anything useful in Eve, you really need to be a part of an effectively organized corporation. So it's not sufficient that you just get some guys who all agree to have the same name tag float above their character's head. You have to actually do things. You have to divide roles and responsibilities. You have to be accountable to each other. You have to pay attention to the calendar. There's a whole realm of social interaction that becomes really, really compelling in that game. And that's the reason that it has grown year over year over year. They started with a very small, sparse game and a relatively small player population. But that was sufficient to generate enough of this interesting activity that it has acted as an attractor. And year on year, they continue to add a substantial number of players. I think they just announced that they have worldwide about 500,000 people who are playing the game. That includes a server in China, which is separate from the rest of the world server, but it's still really impressive that they have that many people playing that game. And that's kind of the path that we intend to take with Goblinworks and Pathfinder Online. We're going to begin with a very small, very sparse game with an intense focus on player interaction with other players, and hopefully we'll experience the same trend line. I wouldn't claim that we'll get the same number, but I'd like to have the graph look the same. And I think that when you experience that for the first time, especially if you are a person who's primarily played MMOs as a single player experience that has other people in the game world with you, you will find it to be transformative. Human beings are social creatures, and we are hardwired by several hundred thousand years of evolution to want to interact with each other and to gain a sense of satisfaction and life value out of interaction. And that is one of the things that's been kind of missing from MMOs almost since the beginning. You could argue that a lot of these things were in Ultima Online. But as the publishers focus on technology and dealing with community issues of misbehavior, they tend to make things more focused on individuals and less focused on the interaction. And I think we're at the cusp of a huge change of going the other direction, where a lot of games that are coming out are going to be focused on that interaction. So. Eve was absolutely in the vanguard of that, and I was really privileged to have worked there and seen it from the inside.
Cool. Eve Online is one of those games that I am fascinated by. I love that there's this, you know, working economy and, like you said, the player interaction behind it. I'm never going to play it. It is not my cup of tea. So I'm really excited about what you can bring to the fantasy realm, but that's just more of my bag. Take a few minutes, maybe go into some specifics if you can, how you're going to bring that kind of interaction to the fantasy world where you can, you know, blow up dragons and kill people.
So the fundamental game design unit in Pathfinder Online is the hex. Not a spell hex, but a geometric shape. Back in the old days, we used to do wargaming on hex paper, and the hex is a great shape for doing territory. So we have created an abstract concept of the hex, and in that hex, things will happen based on the way the players interact with each other and with the elements of that hex, with monsters and resources in the hex. And the primary social unit of the game is the settlement. And so our game is set in an area of the Pathfinder world, which is a wilderness. And the idea basically is that the characters are all going out into the wilderness to settle the land and make their own kingdoms. And so we're kind of evolving the Eve concept, which was focused on corporations, to actually treat the settlements like they're a character. And they're a character that's the sum of all the interactions of all the players who are in them and run them, as well as the people who might visit, live, trade, or make war on them. So there's this kind of multi-layered experience. There's your character, and you have a fully realized life in the game. And then there's your relationship with your social graph, your settlement, plus the larger social graph of how you interact with other characters elsewhere in the world. And then there's this really cool level, which is your settlement. And collectively, you and your friends have to decide what buildings you're going to add to the settlement, what resources you're going to exploit in that settlement. And it's all based on meaningful decisions. So every time you make a choice in that game, you get a benefit, but you also accept a penalty. Or you open a door, but you close the door. So you can't get everything. You will always be getting a little bit of something and nothing of something else, which creates a lot of opportunities for interaction, because the other half of that equation is the other settlement that took the choices different than what you took, which creates, in our goal, meaningful human interaction, which is the core of our whole game. So, you know, this game design tenet of focusing on how do we maximize that interaction, it permeates our whole game design. And we're spending more time on that, frankly, than we are spending on things that more traditional MMO developers spend time on, like really high-end graphics or, you know, really kind of sophisticated AI. We're working on that game design level as opposed to on a technical level.
And what really excites me about all that is that it's very similar to D&D in that, you know, the books that you would buy are very mechanical. There's pluses and minuses and numbers in there. But what really mattered was the stories that were created around that table and things that you would tell your friends, like, oh my God, I can't believe when that thief, you know, totally sneaked in there and stole that guy, and then he got backstabbed, and then he had sex with that prostitute. It was awesome. You know, like, crazy stories.
Do that to a 12-year-old boy.
Don't tell my mom. But what I think is exciting about what you're setting up is the ARGs, you know, the after action reports that will come from all of that that is there, you know. So I'm really excited about what that can bring. But let's shift tracks a little bit. We'll go from MMO to single player.
Sure.
The lonely man over in the corner.
Oh, and they love me.
Today, right now.
That could change at any moment.
Wait until theater. We've talked a lot about how technology is a good thing, and you know that we have concentrated on graphics and things like that. But what will the next year of technology? I feel like we're also on the cusp where a lot of things are about to happen. I don't know if you guys heard, but there's a little thing called PlayStation 4 coming out. Microsoft is busy working on the 375 or whatever it is.
And really stick in the landing.
Yeah, really, exactly. So what will the next generation of consoles really mean for what we're talking about here, being able to actually play a role?
Well, I think that, you know, it's consoles aside, it's about what the tech can do and how you use it, right? So you know, we can look at what I would just fundamentally say that any progress in tech, I think, is going to help us find more parity between, like, the PC platform, which, you know, people don't talk about enough, and it's an enormous market, right? I mean, obviously the MMO guys are pretty comfortable over there, and you know, Dragon Age, we do the interface, and we have a large percentage of our players are PC players, right? I mean, I think we hail back to a PC background.
Yeah. How many of you play Dragon Age on PC?
Woo!
Yeah. Yeah. That's the only real way to play this.
I should have got a photo.
Master race.
Wow, no. That's just weird.
Don't tell the partners that.
Yeah, I know. I got a rant on that, but I'm not doing it here.
That's for later.
So anyway, when you have tech that is improved, when you have more memory, that's one of the things you saw in Sony's conference. What that lets you do is you can do a couple of things. You can jam more and more high-res textures in there. That's one approach. But this kind of goes back to what I was saying about that we're kind of at the point where it looks pretty darn good and pretty darn realistic without having to go a whole lot further. So, you know, the returns diminish. You know, you go from 1024 to 1496. Yeah, you can see that, but, like, you kind of have to get uncomfortably close to see that. So you look kind of creepy. The end result then is you can put more on screen. You can see more happening, right? So you can, I guarantee the Assassin's Creed games, look at the PC ports. Their cities are busier. Everything has got more stuff on and more stuff going on. And I think it means you can maintain more realistic simulations and more realistic, you know, say, state changes and stuff as well. So that if you want to have, say, a greater sense of immersion, and you want to have the crowd go, oh crap, and run if you pull out your sword, mm-hmm. right? In when you're dealing with a tighter space in development, you have to then account for, well, if I can pull out my sword for free, I love to take you on a little trip here, but if I pull out my sword for free, that means I need to have all the animations for combat loaded, and I need to be able to, especially in a party-based game, potentially have up to four full sets of those, because a bow and a staff and a sword and a Sword and Shield are going to be different. So that's eating a ton of your real estate, right? Then, if you have your crowd milling around, they're already using stuff up, the area's already using stuff up, and then you need to add on top of that the fact that the crowd now needs to have responsive reactions. So you need the sound of them yelling, you need the you need their animations when they cower, you need them to start running, and all that stuff might not be there. So this is kind of saying that when you have tech that has more room, more space, better, maybe better streaming off of disk, or maybe, you know, preloaded on a hard drive, which again, PC Plus, all that information can get there a lot faster, it can be kept in memory in anticipation of the player potentially exercising their own free will. Which, whenever you're like, man, I'm looking at a role-playing game and it feels like I can't do whatever I want, man, that's really why, is because there are realistic hardware limitations where sometimes this incredibly fancy ballroom, you know, or the theater from the very beginning of AC3, you couldn't go whipping out your blades, probably because that thing was, like, I could hear my Xbox groaning under the weight of, like, I counted, I was like, that's 72 characters on screen at once, holy shit. You know, and so the end result is that they can then start accounting for a wider range of potential activities and interactions. In memory, they can account for it, visuals, oh cool, we have to spawn corpses, cool, we can do that now, right? That kind of thing, which you don't really think about necessarily, but I think that to me is the greatest opportunity, is saying, good, we can now account for it, so let's let our player do it, take some more of the rails off. You still want a coherent experience, things have to be cohesive, but I think that is the single greatest opportunity when I think about what it does to role playing and the role in the game.
Cool. Now, you mentioned how the PC is better at handling a lot of those different things as it's gone over. I want to trap you here, but like, how much do you have to keep in mind that you're also developing the console at the same time when you're doing things like that?
Well, yeah, it's sticky because when you're making a game, you have to make a game that's a consistent experience across all platforms. Because when people buy the game, they've researched the game, they've, you know, dug into what the experience is going to be. I think there's stuff that, like, you know, with say graphical fidelity or you know, number of creatures that are non-interactive on screen and stuff like that can add texture, but it doesn't fundamentally change the gameplay. Mm-hmm. And so, to use an easy example, on the PC, I could have you fight 50 guys, and on the console, I could have you fight 5 guys. Say that's what the memory's going to allow, or whatever's at work. The sound engine explodes. Take your pick. If that's the case, and we go, oh good, well then for the PC, you have to fight 50 guys. That's either going to kill you instantly if it's balanced for 5 guys, or it's going to make the 5 guy fight so trivial that it's completely unfun, right? Because the 50 guys are supposed to be a challenge, ergo, you know, it's like 99 knights with 3 dudes as your target. It's like done, right? Because they all explode in blood clots. like Berserkers in Bard's Tale 1. So,
that's cool reference.
A fine red mist. So with that being the case, you kind of need to balance the game and build a game that works on both platforms. So I think that there can be some limitations down. That said, it doesn't necessarily mean that makes a bad game, right? Limitations are good. If you give a designer no limitations, they will not make a very good game. If you give them, like, here, you must creatively figure out how to make fighting 5 guys in this space fun because of what we're doing with this thing in Vista, they will go, all right, well, those 5 guys are going to be ridiculous badasses, right? You end up with them pushing the, they find the spaces that they can grow to get the experience that they want, right? And you don't always succeed at that, but you do your damnedest. And I think then, the nice thing is you have parity of experience. If I talk to my friends who played on Xbox, oh yeah, I had that fight too, and that kind of thing. So there are challenges, but I think that there are challenges that if you're cognizant of them early and you prepare for them ahead of time, it doesn't hurt either experience. And then what you do is you take a look at what does not affect, and can you take advantage of the platform to do that? So for us, like, welcome to DA2. Day one, you can download a high-res texture pack as an option if you wanted, and the end result is you've got this, you know, significantly upgraded experience. It did not make the game harder or easier, it just looked better. So that kind of thing becomes open when you have more space to play.
Cool. David, I'm going to throw this over to you as far as new technologies goes. Last year, EQ 2 debuted a new system of the SO emote.
Right.
Can you talk a little bit about that and how players have responded to actually using their face to change their character?
There was a couple. Are you guys familiar with SO emote? Okay, well, if you are, you are. Basically, what it was is the webcam is looking at your face so that
It's I think the best picture of my life.
Basically, it's watching your face and it's analyzing 4,000 bits of info on your face and then distilling that down to virtual mocap dots and transmitting that across to other players in the area. So when you move your face in front of your webcam, your character's face moves too. And then the other part of it is that we do a lot of translating of your voice or filtering of your voice so that you can sound like somebody else when you're on VoIP, which actually ends up being the more popular of the two features, surprisingly. This is really cool in situations where you're close up to another person and you're doing a little bit of role play and stuff, and people experimented with that a lot, but the VoIP filtering actually works everywhere. So you can sound like a little halfling or a big fat troll or the high elf princess if that's your boat.
No judging here at this panel.
But it's all there, and that's it's one of those things like when we were when we were all bound to text chat, of course, it was awkward. You're in the middle of a fight and you get the, you know, the, hey, are you asking to, and you died. So, I mean, that was the end of the, that's the way text chat went. So we put in VoIP so that you could talk to each other, and that was awesome. But it really killed roleplay in a lot of ways because, well, you just don't sound like that high elf princess, I'm sorry. And so, people stopped roleplaying a lot, and we didn't want that, and that's why we brought that back in. And one of the things that I'm really excited about right now is that there's so many of these kinds of peripherals being developed. The Leap Motion guys have a volume of space that's above this little sensor. You can totally do the Minority Report stuff in and be able to manipulate stuff, and, sorry that you were imitating me. and then there was also like these armbands and stuff where you can tap your arm and it's listening to the sounds and your muscles humming and to be able to control your hand, and of course the Google glasses and all these things. And the way I see that coming forward as we go forward is that the PC will become this kind of extraordinarily powerful rendering engine that's sitting up in a closet somewhere, and you're going to be using peripherals elsewhere. You're no longer going to be trapped to your office. You're going to be able to be doing things. And then that leads us to that whole augmented reality frontier, which I personally cannot wait until we get there.
I augmented my reality last night, and it was not worth it.
There's some good stuff coming, and along with the consoles and experimentation with MMOs, and of course you know that we're pushing MMOs onto consoles. DC's been very successful on the PlayStation 3, and you can imagine that we have a whole raft of dev kits sitting at Sony Online.
Yeah. So,
yeah, we're looking forward to it.
Well, and you talked a little bit of how people have adopted the use of this kind of thing. I think that's kind of awesome that it was brought back. Because I talked to people who played MMOs back in the early 2000s, and it was a role-playing experience. There were people who were, I mean, obviously there was going out and camping and doing all the MMO type things, but it came from talking in chat like your character. And then as it blew to a very large audience, that was left by the wayside. I mean, if you go on an RP server on World of Warcraft, there's, you know, still people who are LP looking for group, and you know, none of the roleplay is gone. So I wanted to find out from you, how much did SOE emote? SOE mode, right?
Yeah, right.
There's no SOE emote. Okay.
SOE mode.
How much did that bring back that spirit of roleplaying?
Well, it turned out that the role players were already, I mean, the people that were playing EverQuest and EverQuest 2 are established players. They're a very established community, and they play the games in a certain way. So sometimes when we throw features at them, they're like looking at us like, dude, we already played this other way. So SOE mode caught on with a bunch of what we call win-back people that are returning back to the game, and it caught on with a lot of the new players, but a lot of the established role players already had their kind of set venue on it. Now, like I said, the VoIP stuff, the VoIP filter, has been extremely successful. And that kind of tells us that if we're going to have in features like the facial animations and things like that, they need to be incredibly invisible to the players so that basically they're not having to think about turning it on or having to manipulate it or having to hold their head in a certain way when they're in combat. Those kinds of things need to be solved before we do the next bit. However, something like this would be fantastic in character create. So that's one of the places we're talking about putting it in for EQ2. And of course, we're toying around with stuff like this for EQN also.
Oh, like having like the Me does from Nintendo, where it takes a picture of you and then maps an approximation of what your face would be on your character.
Well, the character creation screens are one of those rare opportunities where you're staring straight into the monitor and you're looking at your face very, very close up. So if SOEMO was playing, let's say you went in there and you started, you went to create a character and the face showed up, and as you started squinting at it, you realized your character was squinting back at you and you didn't have to turn anything on, that would be cool. And it's just one of those things where we're always looking for ways to make more fun in every single step of as people go into the games, and some of this stuff is just going to be cool to do, and that's why we're going to put it in the games.
That's cool.
That's awesome.
Ryan, you touched on it. Ryan's excited. He's going to put it in the Pathfinder online, I think. I wanted to shift tracks a little bit and talk about something you brought up a couple times, which is the AI, and how many times that is the limitation for all the things that we're talking about, that a computer program cannot be as smart as a dungeon master. It cannot imagine the responses to the amazing things that your players do, or amazingly stupid things your players do. So how is AI improving, and how can that really bring this kind of storytelling?
So, it's kind of one of the third little secrets of video game development, that we could build AI right now that would always win.
Yeah.
It's really not that hard to make AI that can beat the players. The hard thing is to make an AI that loses gracefully and makes you feel like you won without having to deal with it. And that's just in a combat environment. In social, AI it hasn't advanced actually much state-of-the-art since the old Bard's Tale days, where you had a script of answers and the software tries to pick the best available choice from a bunch of predetermined options created at design time. I think that's all likely to change in the fairly near future. I mean, I'm not saying this is going to happen next year or even in the next couple of years, but on a time horizon that would be short enough for everybody in this room to experience it, you're probably going to begin interacting with AI in video games that mimics the social capabilities of a human. So there's this concept called the Turing test, which you may have heard of. And the basic idea is that if the computer can interact with a human, and the human can't determine if it's interacting with a computer, the computer is assumed to have achieved some level of human-like consciousness.
That's the goal.
Yeah, that's really the goal. And we're not that far away. So you all know that IBM put a computer into Jeopardy, and it did pretty well. And that computer was comprised of a bunch of server racks, I think it was 20 or 30 racks, and they spent some crazy amount of money on that thing. That technology has now been reduced into one file cabinet. It's being deployed in hospitals to help doctors do diagnostic decision making on the fly. And that was, you know, what, 2-3 years? So 2 or 3 years from now, that level of technology is gonna fit into your cell phone. It's just not that far away. Now, as developers, we all have to learn how to use that technology. So we may get the hardware, we may get the software, it'll still be probably another generation before we really figure out how to make it work in a way that's meaningful, right? But this stuff is all coming really, really quickly. And on top of that, I think you're likely to see this concept of AI being added to your characters. So one of the things you mentioned, you know, I want to do X, Y, or Z and the game won't let me. Sometimes that's a technological limitation, but I would say from a dramatic storytelling point of view, there may be things your character shouldn't be doing because they don't want to. And right now, that's really hard to simulate, and it feels kind of ugly and clunky when the game does it to you, because AI in computer games is just not that great, right? But I don't think we're that far away from a situation where an AI simulation runs inside your character and has its own sense of ethics and morals based on decisions that you've made and choices that you've put into that character, and things that character may have done during its life. And you may put that character in a situation where you want it to do something and it refuses to do so because it's not inherently correct for that character to do it. And if the technology and the software and the development is all right, that experience will feel awesome, not ugly. Right now, it's kind of ugly. We even have this idea that in the long run, your characters will potentially exist independently from you. And they may be doing things when you're not locked into the game based on their nature that you will have to respond to the next time that you log in and check up on what that character is doing. So there's going to be this kind of evolving idea that your character is not just a tool that you're manipulating at the end of your hand, but that character could become, and I'm going to use this term really loosely, more like a pet, an entity with its own consciousness and its own decision-making process that you will interact with and have some degree of agency and control over, but maybe not 100%. And if done right, I think that experience is going to be awesome.
So basically what you're talking about is Skynet. Really?
Is anybody named Sarah Connor?
Have you seen this boy?
See, I...
Raspberry Rifle, 40 megawatt range.
I went to a totally different spot, and there's some Archer fans in the room, I would imagine. My favorite one from the most recent season, and basically, like, you know, logging in my elf princess that I've been, my voice has been modulated to come. And I'm like, wait, you're pregnant? And suddenly I go from guy in charge to disappointed father. That's next gen, man. Shit, it's meta.
So you brought up something else that I want to talk about before we move on to user questions. So if you guys want to ask anything, feel free to start lining up. We have some microphones here. Was the idea of mobiles and how having your phone or your iPad allowing you to check in with your console game, with your PC game, and we've seen some level of that with, you know, the auction house kind of many games have done, and, you know, GChat. But what about like you said, like actually checking in with your character and making real decisions that are not as integral to actually playing the game, but still can advance your character. Mike, do you have any plans to use Dragon Age as a platform on a mobile that is interacting?
I have to be careful. We can talk about, you know, sort of what we've done so far is kind of, we have started exploring this space, and certainly the sense that, you know, like we had the, you know, the sort of just straight up rewards coming out of like Facebook games and that kind of stuff is a good start, right? Where it's like, you know, we're encouraging you to you know, interact with Dragon Age, not necessarily the Dragon Age game that you're about to buy, but at least the world and you know, interface with a part of it, another story, and so on, kind of as a primer and as a way to kind of get used to the world and the lore and cool, this is how dwarves work or what have you. So we've explored that in the past, and you know, speaking very carefully, because we're in that weird space where we've announced and have shown nothing, so.
We were forced to announce, right? So they leaked something?
It's a terribly long story.
And, not the purview of this band.
Yeah, and not particularly uncomfortable either. It's kind of cool. But the thing is that what I would like to see is an experience where I get weirded out if I feel like I have to go on my phone to get to a part of the game that I bought. You know, I bought the game. I want the game to have the game. But I can see a huge opportunity for, especially as the phones become more powerful, to say, okay, so there's a system in the game, and that system's, you know, it's integrated with a bunch of activities in the game itself, but it's modular, like, in terms of interface. And, you know, being able to kind of take that system with you and being able to be like, okay, cool, I'm gonna update this. So, you know, to let's go to Eve. Like, a good Eve example would be, you can't do this currently, you can kind of have to it. On my phone, I have an app where, you know, okay, cool, I can see my skill training queue is done, and my job's in my factory and all that stuff. So I'm made aware that these things have now finished, right? And that's kind of augmenting my reality. Eve is marching onto my phone and getting a notification. That's super cool. And in the case of going a step further is being comfortable with saying, well, you know, you can't break the game, you're not gonna win the story or whatever, but you know, if you really want to craft some armor and you're sitting on the can, well, hey, man, I'm gonna get on that, right? So that kind of approach where if we could take parts of the game and make them mobile, you know, and I mean, the other big example is go back to the can. Would be, in our case, we do all those codex entries and stuff like that. The number of people I've had who've like wanted to take that, like the manual, you remember the manual? We used to have those.
Yeah. I used to take it to school with me and reading.
Exactly, you take it with you because it's a part of the game that's coming with you, and it's helping you learn, and you feel like you're engrossed, and you're excited about this thing you just got. And I think that our phones are at the point where we can start doing that, and we can probably go even further, but I think those are probably the first steps I'd like to take, is to say, can you take part of this game with you, still be engaged, even though, you know, I still want you to come home and thunk down your couch or at your PC and you know, really get lost in the space. That would be kind of my ideal starting point, and then see where we go from there.
Cool. Our goal is to destroy productivity across America's corporate structure.
and since browsers are getting snooped all the time, now we have to do mobile apps. One of our concept artists, and they're all kind of inherently a little bit one-eyed, he was like, you know, if we just put a Faraday cage around the bathroom, everyone would be in and out. And I'm like, you know about Faraday cages? That's cool.
Okay, cool. Let's have the first question.
So, is it working?
Yep.
So, I have autism, and I was very antisocial, until a little gig, whatever, has one. So now I have a 2-ounce size and a 2.8. So thank you. And I'm only question to you. And second, about the magic circle, you guys break it all the time in the main course transportation in these fancy horses. So you try to ride like that, and you have gravity with the angel, you try to ride like that, you will fall straight off. What happens to me? How difficult is it to fix those skills breaks on those character members?
I'll have to find out for you. That's too specific. I'll have to go talk to the dev team and find out for you. Sorry about that. I just don't have the answer. Yeah, but I'm really glad that you're playing EverQuest. That's fantastic. We actually have a very large number of people that have been able to interlink and stuff like that from all over the world, all different kinds of ages, and it's one of those things that makes us like really happy that we're building MMOs, is everybody can participate. It's really cool.
Awesome. So, according to my Street Pass on my 3DS, a lot of people right now are playing Monster Hunter, Fire Emblem, and Etrian Odyssey, which is an Eastern RPG which has nobody on the panel representing right now. So, I mean...
Wait, there are games not made in the Western...
I know, it's crazy. So, you know, given, you know, so we've seen a lot of what we're trying to do in the West now for the future of role and role playing. I mean, there's always been this big divide of, you know, in Eastern games, you usually are assigned a role, except for in games like Etrian Odyssey, where it's completely blank slate, versus the West, where you are the main character and it's completely, and it's very blank slate. So how do you see that as like a, you know, a big movement in the future, like the East and West divide involving role?
Well, I can talk to that, because I think, you know, with them being less single player than they used to be, right? The Monster Hunter kind of integration with your three. Oh man, that's so cool. But without rattling on that, I think that what I've been looking at and seeing is that the divide, I think, has functionally been, do I have a character, or am I kind of the combat coordinator, the combat and exploration coordinator for a team that they're the main characters, right? The Final Fantasies are kind of the hallmark of this. It's like there is a main guy, a main girl, Bob. And I think that what I've been seeing kind of over the years is those divides are kind of blurring a little bit, where there's more customization. Like they're letting a little more customization into the characters' models and their outfits, so that you've got more direct control. Maybe not necessarily over like what they say or what they do, but you do get some of what you call the Western influence, right? Where I have that direct kind of, you know, marionette style control. In turn, I think what we've been looking at is that they have got some really bold kind of storytelling techniques they do, because their characters are not like an avatar for me. They're more willing to explore themes like loss, themes like despair and stuff. And if anything, they've been setting a really good pace for us to kind of say, you know, what if we were willing to explore that and to occasionally give the player a setback, to give you a genuine low, so we have more dramatic structures in our stories. You do run into oogie spots, and we debate this all the time around, like, well, if I do lose control, while Princess gets pregnant, am I losing my agency? Does that make me less as a player? Should I have lost in any way? But I think that what they've kind of demonstrated to me in playing, and I played pretty extensively, is that the recoverable setback, right? The Act 2 dip, was it the Volta, am I remembering that right? And then the recovery from that is as satisfying as, you know, always being a hero and, you know, playing the game to Bonnie Tyler. So I think we've got a lot to learn on both sides, and I think that the divides are getting slimmer and slimmer. They aren't as reliant on cutscenes. We're not as reliant on you know, raw character interaction, and I think ideally we can see the two blend into some sort of cool RPG, but with distinct flavors so people can pick the ones they like.
Cool. Good question. Sorry I didn't invite any these term developers.
we're in Boston, it's hard.
Yeah, it's easier to get this.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Go ahead.
You talked earlier about sort of the progression in graphical fidelity and how when you rely less on imagination, you have to have a whole team of artists that creates all these unique areas. I was hoping you could speak a little bit more to like the gameplay and physics things of making games more simulation-based, because I worked on physics at a AAA developer, and I found that whenever we just let the physics engine do something, it wasn't fun. So we had to always like go back then and do like weeks of work trying to integrate as a player can land a helicopter flying at 40 miles per hour or something stupid like that. So, sort of, how do you see that going? Do you think there's going to be like fewer finely tuned experiences, or what's going to happen as worlds get more realistic?
Well, if you're going to build a sandbox that's compelling, you kind of have to first decide where your boundaries are going to be, the kind of fences and stuff that both the players and the designers are working inside of, and making sure that there you can do like many, many, many different creative things with different combinations of a very few abilities. That's the perfect world. And physics and stuff like that fits into that kind of sandbox really, really well, because the sandbox can affect like a certain number of things, and then its interactions of how those things fit together. It's kind of like when they used to do those grenade physics demos for Halo back when. You guys remember those, where they'd like catapult the Jeep like 40 miles? It was cool. But I mean, that wasn't designed as a sandbox, but because there was a very few elements, and because there were some serious physics involved with those elements, they were able to do really crazy stunts by figuring out the combinations of things that you could do with those. So physics can be used very effectively in a sandbox, and you can do all kinds of cool stuff. And I'll leave the rest for August.
I'll just really quickly say, I think what you're really talking about is the difference between art and science. I think that if you just run a raw simulation that's just correct, it will not be fun. And so it has to be altered, and that's where art comes in, and that's a bunch of decisions made by humans about what other humans will think is interesting. So I think that, you know, in the short term, you're going to see a lot of fixing. We, you know, the physics engine and it does a weird thing, and that's not fun, and so we're going to alter the game mechanics so that it is fun. In the long term, maybe we'll have AI assistants to find those problems before they occur, but I still think you're going to have a lot of handcrafted corner case decisions. Landing helicopters in 40 mile an hour winds is probably fun, and so a human is probably going to have to decide to make it possible.
There's a difference between like Gary's Mod is not a game, but yeah. All the things that are made with Gary's Mod could be. So yeah. Yeah. The tools can be there, but you still need a creator who's making it. Well, good question. Thank you.